Out of all these hundreds of thousands of ancestors that you have, they all came down to one point, which was you.
I want to have a history. I want my children to have a history. I want to know where that line has come from.
I feel slightly nervous because, it's like with anything, once you start digging, you don't know what you're going to find, do you?
Are they actual skulls of people? This may be a distant relative.
I'm looking for John Joseph Day.
You've found him.
And Marty.
Hello.
Hello, the girls are all here.
Hello. Hello, my long-lost family.
At each stage, the matter-of-fact script on a birth certificate or a record of baptism or a will has led and unravelled the most extraordinary personal stories here.
He's a greengrocer. He's a greengrocer. That's fantastic.
Don Diego, you son of a gun.
I've noticed that there are quite a number of women who are the heads of the household. In fact, almost all of them are.
They're not hookers, are they? Are they prostitutes?
Oh, are they?
Aha!
Aha!
Ich habe der Mystery gekracked.
Do you know, this isn't too good to be true, Dr. Nyman. I mean, this stuff in pencil. How do I know the BBC hasn't crept in and written this?
Minstrel. Minstrel. These are minstrel.
Oh, boy.
This document is truly remarkable, isn't it? And, you know, my relatives, my blood ancestors are on this page.
Right there.
I found it.
Yes.
It's hard because we take so much for granted because we're not face to face with the real stories.
When his officials were killed, he was still there fighting.
Amazing.
What I have now done with this world, and I'm going to a better. I forgive all the world heartily, and I thank God I die in charity with all men. It is awful. I never even knew him, but I just think it's so awful.
Yes.
Oh, this is gonna make me cry. It's so sweet. From his mouth, it's from the mouth of one of the angels. Of Lord of Hosts. It's sweet.
So I can only tell you what the story was at the time, and that was that he was playing Russian roulette.
Now, as I look at him, knowing that he's Jessie's son, and I know her story, there's a whole different sort of connection as I look at him, and it's almost as if I'm feeling that they know I know.
I have a history for him which is richer than any history I'd had before. And right at the heart of that history is a human being. And I don't think he had been a human being for me.
It's changed everything about who I thought I was. Everything.
So who do I think I am? I'm a link in the chain of a wonderful family. I'm blessed.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us here at the special DocFest event that we've got lined up for you this afternoon. And I think, you know what, when you watch that, it just shows what great TV is all about. And I'm sure everybody in here is a fan. But I just wondered, just before we do get started, if we could just have a show of hands. I'm just trying to find out how many industry professionals are here. Could you raise your hand? I think we can just about see. And how many members of the public, fans of the show, are here? Yeah. I think we're surrounded by friends, guys. Well, before I do get started, I just wanted to just remind everybody that Sheffield DocFest is just on for another 2 days, today and tomorrow. It's just great that this event can be hosted here in Sheffield. I think we've got 120 films. I think there's 24 world premieres. We've got, just a massive list of people who are giving talks, and both film industry insiders and household names. And I just looked down the list, and some of the people I've met this week, Michael Palin, Sir Trevor MacDonald, Melvin Bragg, Joe Cocker, Richard Hawley, Alan Yentob, Captain Sensible. Do you know what? It just sounds like another series of who do you think you are? But here we are today, obviously, to talk about the series that's been 10 years in the making so far, celebrating its first decade. And so we've got a great panel of guests here today, and I'm going to introduce them to you in a minute. But before I do that, just some facts and figures about the show that I'd just like to part with you as well. It was first aired in October 2004 on BBC Two. It moved to BBC One for Series 3 in 2006. 90 episodes have been made in the UK, and the 10th series is about to be transmitted this summer. We're going to get a couple of exclusives, I think, in terms of who's going to be taking part in that and a few more details. The 2014 series is in production, and it will include, obviously, the 100th episode. And the series has hit 7.2 million viewers and averages 5.7 million. Over 300 hours of Who Do You Think You Are have been transmitted around the world. And it's now been, or is presently in production, in all these countries. I'm going to list them. This is ridiculous. It's Australia, Sweden, the USA, Netherlands, Denmark, Norway, the Czech Republic. I'm just going to get my breath. Republic of Ireland, Canada in English, Canada in French, Israel, South Africa, and a studio version in Poland. I mean, it's just amazing that the fact that it's all started here. Wall to Wall is the company who will make it, and I'm going to introduce you to the people behind that. And its sister company in the LA produces a US version that is now in its fourth series. There are the usual books, DVDs, but since 2007, there's been a live event at Olympia attracting about 14,000 people, and a monthly magazine now with a circulation of 22,500. And I think, you know, when we look at the clip that we've just seen there, we understand the fascination for this. I think in terms of BBC terms, it is informative and it's also entertaining. And it's a roller coaster, isn't it? It was just nice to hear all the giggles and the laughter as you were watching that, because normally in our own homes, we watch it alone. But to see that this programme actually grabs emotions is superb, and a great montage, and we've got some more clips to come. But before we do that, obviously, I just want to introduce you to everybody who's here on stage. First of all, to my right, this is Alex Graham. He's the CEO of Wall to Wall and executive producer on the UK and US series. And as many people will know, he's closely associated with DocFest. Then we've got Leo Burley, who's director. He directed the Bruce Forsyth and Emily Fox and the J.K. Rowling episodes. And here's a bit of an exclusive for you, the forthcoming Mini Driver episode, which is going to be in this series. And then we've got Maxine Ostwald, who was producer, who actually produced the Larry Lamb episode, as well as J.K. Rowling, William Roche, and whether or not we ought to go into that one. And in the next run, we've got Eunice Stubbs, Leslie Sharp and John Simpson. And then, of course, we've got our superstar on the end, who I don't think takes much introducing. He's been on our screens for over 30 years. Most famously has been in Gavin and Stacey and rather nasty Archie Mitchell in EastEnders. And he's really as nasty in that in real life. He'll now be found on The One Show. And if he manages to get his train home, he's actually going to be on the radio in the morning. He's got an LBC radio show that he does on Sundays. There we go, that's the panel. What I'd like to, first of all, we might as well rewind and go right back to the start. And Alex, if I can ask you, obviously you've been asked this question many times, but how did the idea come about?
I should say, I'm not very, it's the one, I've been in telly for about 30 years, it's the one genuine idea I've actually, most of the ideas we've done at Wall to Wall, I've sort of managed to steal from somebody else, but actually, who do you think you are? It's probably the only idea I've ever had of my own. There's not that many TV professionals on this, but I would say Who Do You Think You Are is a great example of, if you've got an idea and you really believe in the idea, don't give up on the idea. I had the idea for what became Who Do You Think You Are actually in 1989, more than 20 years ago, just 14 years before we finally got it on air, so it took a while. It was very simple, really. I was reading an interview with Billy, for those of you who may not recognise the accent. I come from Glasgow. And I was reading an interview with Billy Connolly in a magazine, and it struck me, happy to, that his, and he talked about his dad, and he talked about his relatives working in the shipyards of Glasgow, and I suddenly realised Billy's story was, I mean, not so much my story, although there were bits about that overlap with me, but it was a lot of Glaswegian's story. And I suddenly thought, I wonder if we could get Billy, or someone like Billy, to tell that story, to explore that story on television. Then we might have something that, you know, people would come to it because it was Billy, but there would be a universality to the story. And it seemed like a really, I mean, all the great ideas I've been involved in have a kind of simplicity about them. And this just seems like a really simple idea. I mean, as I say, unfortunately, it took about 14 years to persuade the broadcasters that they should do it. But we finally sold it to the BBC in 2000, well, actually sold it in 2003. The first series went out in 2004. I mean, the weird thing about it is it was never meant to be a returning series. It was only ever meant to be 10 episodes. I pitched it to the BBC and said, BBC had done Simon Sharma, and they'd done a show called Restoration, where you got to vote for, you know, they'd done a show called Great Britain. So it was Jane Root was running BBC Two at the time, and had kind of introduced a whole new range of different ways of doing history and telling. And I pitched Who Do You Think You Are as a 10-part series. The idea was it's going to be an alternative history of Britain. 10 celebs, 10, and we'd find celebs who represented different bits of British history. So we'd have a film about, I thought we'd have a film about the First World War, the Industrial Revolution, the Civil War, film about Ireland, a film about Scotland, and so on and so forth. And that would be great. We'd do it for 10 episodes, and we'd kind of have a different way of looking at British history. And I never thought it would. I mean, the idea that I'm sitting here talking about series 10 is just a bit weird to me, really.
And did the first series turn out the way you intended it to do, or did it quickly evolve into something else?
Well, it did. I mean, yes and no. I mean, I think in so many ways, Who Do You Think You Are still, I mean, what I love about it is it still takes you into bits of history that, I mean, every show takes you into a different kind of history. But the very first episode we did was, first episode we shot, and also, as it happens, the first episode that we ever transmitted was Bill O'Day. And Bill's film, in our head, when we approached Bill, Bill's film was going to be the Industrial Revolution film. Because Bill came from Lancashire, came from Rochdale, I think, but, you know, he came from Milltown. And so we wanted, but when we went to see Bill, he was very polite, and he said, well, yeah, I'm sort of interested in the Industrial Revolution, but I'm much more interested in my mum. And when I was a wee boy, I think he used the word wee, but yeah, when I was a little boy, my mum was never there. She was ill. I never really understood what was wrong with her. She was in hospital for a long time. He suspected, because he'd started to have some bouts of depression himself, that this she may have had some kind of depressive illness. And we were confronted with an obvious choice, which is either we said, well, that's very interesting, Bill, but we really want you to do the Industrial Revolution, or we said, actually, the motivation of the celebrity to explore their story is much more powerful. And so almost without realizing it, and again, this is a characteristic of a lot of the really good things that I've been involved in. The best shows are shows where you start off thinking you're making one thing, and halfway through you realise you're actually making something else. And the trick is to realise that and to respond to it. And so I suddenly found myself, I still remember watching, there's a little, those of you who have seen Bill O'Day's, there's a clip where we eventually track the roots of Bill's mum's depression to a, she had a child about a year before Bill was born, who died just at age 5 days old. And I still remember the moment where Bill collects the death certificate of the sister that he never had, a sister who died before he was even born. And I remember watching it and the hair standing on the back of my neck and thinking, actually, this is something quite different from what I thought it would be, and potentially quite powerful.
And do you know, I mean, there's a public fascination, I think, with celebrity, and that obviously drives the show, because all your subjects are celebrities. But even ordinary people in the street, I mean, my great-grandfather and his two brothers died on the first day of the Battle of the Somme, an absolutely extraordinary story, and, you know, the inspiration from the series it sent me out to France to actually investigate it. I think that's how it touches people. Do you think that it's necessary that we have to have a celebrity as the central character?
Well, first thing to say is I think it's absolutely fantastic that the show inspired you to go, and that's one of the things that I'm most proud of the show is that it has, I think that your story is quite a common one, that you know people watch the show and then want to go off and find their own family history, and in a way that was one of the things that we really wanted the show to do, is to inspire people. I mean, I think there's two answers to your question. I mean, one is the cynical answer is to say, well, we could do ordinary people, but you know, would we get 6 million viewers on BBC One for someone that no one had heard of? Probably not. And I've always, the thing about Who Do You Think You Are was, it's been an opportunity to take history onto BBC One. I mean, there has been history on BBC One, but not much. And most of it involves men, and most of it involves men in uniform of one kind or another. And Who Do You Think You Are has expanded the range of history on BBC One, and I'm not really apologetic about that. The other answer to your question is, of course, we do feature ordinary people. The great thing about Who Do You Think You Are is all the people in our film are all, or in a genealogical sense, they're all ordinary people. They're just ordinary people who happen to become famous through talent, through luck, whatever. Most of our people are first-generation celebs, and their family stories are just like yours or just like me.
Or in Larry's case, I suppose, lion tamers. But again, we'll move on to that.
Okay. Yeah.
In terms of the show, did you make any mistakes?
Oh, no, of course not. No, we never make mistakes. What a ridiculous question. You always make, again, it's about, I don't think you can be properly creative without making mistakes. You know, I say to my team, you're allowed to make any mistake. You're only allowed to make it once. If you make it twice, that's a different thing. No, we did. The big mistake I made early on, first series, I was obsessed with the fact that I wanted this to be, I was scared that it would be boring. How many of you are actually some amateur genealogists? So actually, how many of you have actually researched your own family history up to a point? I mean, one of the criticisms I get from people who actually do it themselves is that we make it look too easy and we make it look too interesting sometimes. It is actually, for those of you who've done it, it can be really dull. And I was like worried about it, so I used to, early on, I banged on at the team. I said, look, I don't want this series to be endless sequences shot in libraries and church halls and so on and so forth. Actually, to the extent where, I mean, we've got a clip here, I think. So much did I go on about this that one particular celebrity took it on himself to take the mickey out of me on camera. I'm not sure he thought the sequence would get into the film when he did it, but I liked it so much. Can we just run the Jeremy Clarkson clip?
We were told, were we not, before we set off on this epic voyage, not to film in any graveyards, no mournful shots, people wistfully looking at graves and cue adagios for strings and walk off. But we're not doing that. I just wanted to say that is Clarkson genetic landfill. You can time me how long it takes me to find a Clarkson gravestone.
On your marks, get set, go.
Vors, Potten, Clarkson.
10 seconds.
I'm not sure they thought that would actually get in the final show, but I thought it was so funny that we found a way of keeping it in. The point of the story is that actually, of course, I was just wrong. That Bill Oddie moment was a moment, you know, I realised the document. I mean, a lot of people cry in this show. It's become a bit infamous for people crying. And I would say probably 3/4 of the people who cry at the moment that they're confronted by an original document, you know, their ancestor's signature, a birth certificate, a death certificate. The power of the document you saw it in the montage, actually, there's quite a lot of examples there. I can't really explain it, And in fact, a lot of the celebrities struggle with it. You know, they often say on camera, I didn't know these people. You know, these people lived hundreds of years ago, but somehow there is this emotional kind of arc, you know, electrical arc that kind of connects them. And I it's strange to me. It's, even after 10 years, it's still strange to me the power of the document. But so that was, I mean, that was the big mistake. I mean, fortunately, we learned from that mistake quite quickly. And as you now know, the entire series is shot in libraries of one kind or another.
Leo, if I could bring you in as a director, and just following on from that point, are there certain ingredients or techniques that you always try to include in an episode? You know that they're going to work.
Well, it's not quite that planned, but I mean, I think the most important thing as a director when I come on board is that I look for the most powerful stories. You know, I'm presented with several ways I could go, and obviously you're looking for dramatic storyline. And these documentaries are probably as close to drama as you can get in documentary. They're not like other films that I've made in the sense that each scene has to earn its place in the film. You have to hit certain marks, certain emotional marks in each scene, otherwise they just don't work. And it's a lot more difficult than it looks, but that's what I look for initially. I look for the strong story.
I suppose, you know, the man in the street, myself, I'm going to look at it and we're going to think that how much of this is genuine, how much is acted, how much of this is acted out? Do you revisit anything, or has it got to be seen? Have you got to film it as it happens, or would you go back and actually say, let's recreate that?
You cannot go back on this. Everything is as you see it. Nothing is recreated, nothing is faked. The celebrities simply don't know what's going to happen next, and that's the key fact in this. When we were working with J.K. Rowling, as far as she was concerned, her great-grandfather had won the Légion d'Honneur, and she'd stood up in front of the world's press next to President Sarkozy of France and said that, and that's how the film starts, and that's where she starts. That happened not to be the case. We had a fairly brilliant researcher who found out that her great-grandfather hadn't won the Légion d'Honneur. In fact, someone of the same name had won the Légion d'Honneur, and somehow her family had translated that into this great award, and she'd stood up in front of the world's press and said, this is not the first Légion d'honneur in my family, and it's such a proud moment for me. She was therefore pretty scared when it became apparent that this hadn't happened. And how you treat that story, how you take the audience through that story and the celebrity at the same time, is the success of this format. It's how you treat it.
Have you ever reached a point, perhaps in a case like that, where somebody's actually thought, I don't want to go on with the show, I don't want to do it anymore?
Just once. But we got them back. Patsy Kensah. Patsy agreed to do the show. Patsy knew that her dad, she knew that her dad was an East End gangster, ran with the Richardsons, and so she knew that there were bad people in her family, but she was hoping that there might be some redemption later on. And when we went back, so we dealt with her dad, and then we went back to her grandfather. Her grandfather was fought in the First World War, and so she thought, oh, great, my grandfather's a war hero. So we took her to the Imperial War Museum, and she opens up the records and discovered that her grandfather was dishonorably discharged from the army for theft. And at that point, she just lost it. I mean, she was really upset, and she said, I don't want to do this. And she pulled out, and we had a slightly panic-stricken 4 or 5 days talking to her, talking to her agent. And as Leo says, the difficult thing is, what we really wanted to say was, don't worry, it'll be fine. We know the end of the story, and it'll all be fine. But of course, we couldn't say that, because, you know, we had to say, what we did say was, look, trust us, you know, we are not going to make you look awful. But you have to trust us that there will be a story and that you will go. And anyway, after about 4 days, she came back. And actually, I don't know if you've seen that episode. It's actually one of the more sort of raw, more emotional episodes we've ever done. But I think there is, Leo and Maxine might talk about it. And be interested to hear Larry's kind of view of this as well. But I mean, I think we have a sort of saying about the sort of the 3-day wobble. The sort of 4-day wobble that celebrities often, they get into the story, and then, as Leo says, you know, I mean, I describe it sometimes as a bit like the television equivalent of being bundled into a white van, blindfolded, and dumped somewhere, you know.
Well, Alex, you mentioned Larry, and Larry, I'm going to bring you in at this stage and just say, in terms of you've been through the experience, so I suppose rather than it be called what it is, it could almost be called My Life in Your Hands. But how did you find that experience? Were you very trusting?
I think the thing is, you know, it's that you don't have to do it, you know. They didn't put handcuffs on you until you know that's it. You don't have to do it. It's up to you. You get asked in to talk about your life because you are considered to be somebody who's potentially has got the right sort of profile, as we've talked about before, because that's what's necessary to be a subject of the program. So from that point on, it's you deciding you want to go with it. As far as I'm concerned, you have to trust. You have to trust in what they're going to do. And if you fear what there might be to be found, then you shouldn't get into it. That's my answer to that. It's I entered into it because most of my life was to me was a mystery. So anything that was going to offer some sort of an answer to any part of it was a positive. But I certainly didn't look into, you know, maybe finding out that, you know, I was directly related to Ivan the Terrible or something. It didn't really worry me.
Max, obviously just talking about the appeal of the show, and I guess that part of the appeal from an onlooker's point of view, from the public looking in, is you know, just like the subject matter, nobody quite knows where this is going to end up, apart from you guys.
Exactly, and it's a very strange position to be in, because when I first met Larry, I thought, actually, I know a lot more about your family than you do. You know, and it's really odd, and I've talked to all your family members and found out about the history behind it. And I remember once we were sitting at dinner before a day's filming, and you kind of, you know, you half explain, well, tomorrow you're going to meet somebody and we want you to think about this, but it's all a huge surprise. And you're in a very privileged position, I think. I feel it's quite extraordinary. And sometimes people really want to try and get stuff out of you and sort of say, and they try and look at the call sheet, or they try, and you have to be like a policeman on set as well. When you've got your celebrity at lunch, for example, and they want to talk to the expert, if the expert's having lunch with you, then they might start talking about something. Say, no, you can't talk about that yet because we want to get it on screen and we want to get it for the first time. So you sort of have to say, well, don't talk about it.
They're guarding you all the time. That's the thing. And all those clipboards. With mine, it was a bunch of these women. They were just the worst bunch of women.
Who do you think you are? It's mainly women.
No, that's what I mean. It's like witches all standing there with their clipboards, like, and they're literally, you can read it across their face. We know all about you, but we're not going to let you know. And they torture you day after day after day. And of course, my sister was the link through, because they needed a link through. And my sister was even worse on the phone because, you know, she really got it over me. There were things she could not tell me, and she just loved that.
Yes. I have to say, your sister was totally brilliant.
Yeah.
Because that's the other thing. You get to talk to the family members. But then you also have to say, look, please don't tell, you know, your brother or your aunt. Please don't tell them what we're researching, because we don't want them to find anything out before they actually find it out on screen. And they have to have the trust in you as well. And so you build up these extraordinary relationships with everybody where they are very, very trusting, because they want to find out about their families. And for them, it's almost their journey as well, isn't it?
As a performer, just to say, as a performer, the worst thing in the world you can ever be asked to do is to recreate a surprise situation. It's horrible. It's a horrible thing to have to even step into it. But you just never do, because there it is. It's kind of like they've knitted together the whole thing on paper, right there. The program's basically set on paper. You go out, and then they film you being exposed to it. So there's never a chance of that. It's an extraordinary experience.
But Larry,
as a viewer, you can tell.
Yeah.
I think you know when you see something that's real. I mean, I know I do on TV, and I think that's the thing. That's what makes these shows so exciting to make, is that spontaneous moment.
Yes.
That moment. There are months and months and months of planning that goes into that.
And Maxine's right. I mean, actually, the hardest thing to do, I mean, when we started doing the show, I watched a lot of programs where people go in search of things or go on quests. It's quite classic sort of television format. And actually, if you watch them, you're surprising how many of them are really just not very satisfactory, because the truth is, people, you do need to know. Well, certainly the production team needs to know where they're going, because we have a limited amount of time and a limited amount of money to make each of these episodes. And so you often see, I mean, the classic one is, you've all seen this, you know, when somebody walks up to a big house and they say, I'm just going to say, I wonder if there's anyone in. And you think, of course there's somebody in. You've turned up with the film crew. You're not going to come up and not know that there's somebody in the house. And I think Leo's absolutely right. I mean, the irony is, people say to me, oh, you know, is it real? You know, do they really not know what they're doing? And I say, but the moment that they didn't, the moment that you did know them, I mean, there's June Whitfield, bless her. We really wanted June early on, like first or second series, and we rang up. And normally it takes quite a long time, even people who are keen, to reel people in to do the show. People are quite often reluctant. We got a phone call back the next day from June's agent. June would love to do this. She's so excited. How quickly can we set up a meeting? Well, you know, tomorrow, whatever. So we all kind of turn up and meet. And June arrives at this meeting, and she's got under her arm, she's got two box files. And she walks into the room, she goes, I am so excited about this. She said, I know everything there is to know about my family history. And we just went, I don't think this is going to work then. And so sadly, we couldn't do it because she knew too much.
But Larry, just coming back to the point of it being a bit of a blank sheet when you first start the journey and not kind of quite sure where you're going. I mean, yours was an extraordinary story that even took you to Los Angeles. I mean, weren't you told right at the beginning you better have your passport ready because we're going somewhere special?
Well, that's interesting you say that, because normally they don't, in fact, all they do is they say, right, we're going to pick you up in a taxi, bring your passport. But they got into trouble with me, because the point was that to go to America as an actor, to be presenting, as it were, on paper, a television program, albeit that it is about you, you have to have a work visa. And that really got them in, you know, that was a jam, because to get a work visa, I needed to give them all my details so that the visa application could be filled out. And so, in the end, I had to go to the American embassy to get a work visa. So I absolutely knew where I was going. But normally, what they do is just turn up, get your passport, and change your clothes, and we're off.
And Maxine, really interesting when we were talking about the kind of casting side of it all and the research side of it. You've had some absolutely amazing names on here, and people like J.K. Rowling, for instance. I mean, the fact that you managed to get her to open up and be public, I think it's one of the highlights of the entire 10 years. Mm. But there must be some great names on the wish list that you've either not been able to get or you'd like to get. I mean, is there anybody on there who you'd like to bring?
I don't know, Alex. I don't know if there are any.
Oh, it's a long list.
Yeah.
I mean, there's still a long. I mean, you know, it's a fantastic list that we've got, but you know, I've got an even longer list of people who I can't persuade. I mean, some people will just never do it. I think there's a certain kind of person who just, you know, they don't comfortable being themselves on camera, and you know, so there's got a lot of, you know, there's a long list of people, and then there are other people who kind of say they don't want to do it. Actually, we've got one person, I'm not allowed to say who it is, sadly, lined up for next year, who we're filming later this year for 2014, and she has she said no about half a dozen times over the last decade. But we finally got her. And I think the reason we got her is that someone she knows quite well has done the series and has gone. I think that one of the nice things is that when people do it, they, most of the time, almost all the time, they have a very good experience. So we finally reined this person in, and they'll be in next year's show. A long list of people. The hardest part is that because it's so expensive and so complex, we've got the most fantastic research team I've ever worked with, actually. Because it's so complex and expensive to do the genealogical research, we can't research anyone's story on spec. We need to know that they are at least interested in principle. So what that means is we end up having a conversation with the celeb saying, you know, we get to the point where they say we'd like to do it, and we have a meeting. And then we have to say to them, look, we'll come back to you in a few weeks' time or a couple of months' time and tell you whether you've got a story or not. And of course, quite often, I'd say maybe in half the cases, probably, but one in two, we have to go back and say, I'm sorry, you may be fascinating, but your family so far isn't. That's quite a tough conversation.
I've got to mention, we've got one of our most famous sons here in South Yorkshire, and he's a personal friend of mine, so he'll not mind me saying this, but Michael Parkinson?
Yes, I know, poor old Michael. But it's funny, we were talking earlier about some, you know, people's fear of what might happen in the show. I think all the celebs' biggest fear is being boring. We say to people, look, you wouldn't trust us. We wouldn't be making a film with you if your family story was not interesting in the first place. I mean, it's difficult, this, actually, because what I honestly think, having done this for 10 years, is that everyone does have a story. I actually think everyone has a story in their family. The problem is who do you think you are? It's not a badly funded show. It's actually got quite a decent budget for a factual series. But actually, we spend that money, and the reason we spend that money is because the research is enormously difficult. And I think if we had an infinite amount of money and an infinite amount of time, we'd probably find a story for everyone. But we don't, and we often have to cut off, at a certain point, we have to say, we can't do any more research. We can't afford to do any more research. We're going to have to just stop this,
I think it's quite interesting because the researchers, who are totally brilliant, I mean, they spend a huge amount of time looking at stories, and a lot of them say they might have 2 weeks where they can't find anything, and they're looking at archives and they're talking to experts, and they cannot, pin somebody down to a certain time, and you have to sort of pin people down. There has to be a document, and I think it can be quite off-putting, I think, as a researcher, when they can have a week or 2 weeks where they just can't get it, and then all of a sudden they'll have a breakthrough. It's like being a detective. It's incredible, and they have to be so precise.
You said earlier about, you talked about being a policeman on the set, and actually it is, I think that's absolutely right. I think the research process on Who Do You Think You Are is actually much more like a detective trying to solve a crime. In other words, you will go, we do another show for BBC One called New Tricks, which is a drama. And actually, I often think that the kind of experience that the Who Do You Think You Are team go through is a bit like UCOS on New Tricks, that you can go for weeks and weeks and weeks trying to piece together. And then suddenly, literally in the space of 24 hours, you've made the breakthrough. You've found the perpetrator, you've found the story.
I suppose you have to have budget, though, set aside for the fact that you will hit some dead ends.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. There's quite a lot of money doesn't make it onto the screen.
And the other thing is, of course, sometimes while you're shooting, revelations happen. It's a living beast, so you have to incorporate the history into the show as you go. It isn't all set in stone before you start. Although, as Max says, the researchers are fantastic.
And also, you might come on board and you might want to go down the director might want to go down a slightly different route, and something that you haven't looked into, and research still goes on when the production starts.
That's important to say, actually. I mean, you're often presented with two or three stories, and, there are often fairly tense meetings where you have to make a decision about which line of the family or which story to go with. And it's a big call because you're not quite sure how these things are going to work out. Sometimes the history and the story is better in one direction, but the subject, the celebrity, is much more interested in the other. And there's a big pull then, and you have to make an editorial call, which we tend to do as a team, and then Alex decides.
Well, no, I say no.
Well, I guess, Alex, one of the calls there was when Maxine and Larry were in Los Angeles, and for the, I think, week or two that they were there, or less, it rained, didn't it?
Yeah.
And they were complaining there weren't any blue skies. Surely you could have put that off a week and had some nice sunshine.
That would have been nice, wouldn't it?
It'd be lovely.
No, it
lovely.
Rain, didn't it?
And you know,
never rains in Los Angeles.
You've mentioned a couple of times about the budget, and I'm going to try and pin you down a little bit on that. I mean, it seems to me as though it's not. It probably is very cost-effective TV, but it's not cheap because you have to research it all. You have to go out and do it all again. What kind of cost is it per episode?
Am I allowed to say this? Anyone from the BBC here? what I'll say is, I'm not sure I'm going to quote the exact number because I think that's unfair to the BBC, but I would say it is at the top end of what the BBC would pay for a factual series. On the other hand, it gets audiences which are broadly equivalent to drama. You know, it gets 5-6 million kind of audiences you get for Spooks or Hustle or so on and so forth. So, I mean, in terms of the cost, if you divide the cost by the number of viewers, it's a pretty, it costs about a third of a, it's about probably about 50% more than an average factual show. Maybe, 30 to 50% more, but it's about a third of a drama. And so, in that sense, it's a big show.
Your viewing figures justify it because you've got millions of people tuning in. But does it all come down to that? I mean, if they dip, are you fair?
No. I don't think. Well, that's not a question for me. That's a question for BBC. I mean, but I think, to be honest, I mean, I genuinely believe this. I mean, I've always felt that what the great thing about Who Do You Think You Are is that it actually shows that you can do a genuinely popular series, but without compromising the intelligence of what you do. And I said earlier, the thing I'm most proud of is that we bring sometimes really quite obscure bits of history onto BBC One. And I mean, Larry's film, which takes us into a really fascinating world of kind of circus and entertainers. We've had David Dickinson took us to the Armenian massacres in Turkey. We explore things, and if I went into pitch to the BBC, I said, I'd like to do a one-hour film about the Armenian massacres in the early 20th century for BBC One at 9 o'clock, they show me into a darkened room and lie me down until I came to my senses. Those are the kind of things that you get. I mean, you might, if you're lucky, get a half hour on Radio 4 at 4 o'clock in the afternoon on a subject like that. But we are putting that kind of history, quite complicated, sometimes really almost untold history, on BBC One at 9 o'clock. And I don't know another show that does that. So I think, obviously, the BBC are very happy with the viewing figures, but I think it's also a show which plays to the values of the BBC. I think it's a classic public service television programme.
Yeah, well, I think most people in the room would agree with you on that one. Obviously, a lot of planning goes into that, and I'd like to just concentrate a little bit on that. And Leo, at the end of the day, for all the planning, it's all about the end result. You're in charge. So no pressure. No pressure there. To a point, he says. Yeah. But what do you most enjoy about directing the episodes?
The first show I made was about Bruce Forsyth, and it was a fairly terrifying experience as well because they aren't like other documentaries. And when I came on board, I started to realise what I was up against. And Bruce and I struggled quite a lot at the beginning. He didn't enjoy the way in which we had to work. He didn't quite understand what I wanted, and I wasn't brilliant perhaps. But we finally managed to get along. And there was one moment when we were in London, we were in the Arts Club in Mayfair, and the whole programme had been about the revelation that his great-grandfather had been a bigamist and had had two families, one in America and one in England, of which he knew nothing about. A woman in America had written to him and said, I think we're related, and he'd written back saying, I don't think so. And the film followed his exploration of this letter. But there was this moment in the Arts Club. And I think it really caught the public imagination. It was only, it was only about 30 seconds, but it was just this self-reflection that you never really see of Brucey on telly, but he looked into his own life and he looked at his own patchy record as a husband. And for a moment, he was quite quiet. And I was there at that moment, and there was a real quietness in the room. And if there's one thing I love about this series, it's that. It's the unexpected element of what you can bring out of someone that the public think they know, and another face. I'd say that's the most exciting thing.
I think we saw that quite famously in the J.K. Rowling episode, and I think we've got a clip. Could we run that clip?
One of these men is your great grandfather, Louis Vallon. This is service record.
In the October battle, he took command of a section and held his men under violent fire. With the greatest calm, he... Oh, my God. He killed.
He killed.
Several German soldiers.
For protecting his position and defending his comrades.
Oh my God. He was seriously injured in the arm and the side by
A shell.
A shell.
A shell.
Okay. Oh my goodness me.
So, Louis Volant, your great-grandfather, who was, before the First World War, an ordinary man, a waiter.
He was a waiter.
And a good soldier when he was a conscript.
Yeah, but
yes.
15 days training for this.
Yes, became, in Courcelle, a hero. When his officers were killed, he was still there, fighting.
Amazing.
For his bravery, your great-grandfather won La Croix de Guerre. The Legion d'Honneur is an award for officer class. The Croix de Guerre is an award for the fighter.
It's better. The Croix de Guerre is much better than the Legion d'Honneur.
That's the fighter medal.
That's amazing. That's absolutely amazing.
In your family, have you a Croix de Guerre?
Not that I'm aware of,
no.
No?
Here?
You are joking.
I have La Croix de Guerre with a bronze star.
Exactly the same that your great-grandfather won.
And I will be very, very honored if you accept it.
Thank you so much.
In memory of your great-grandfather.
Thank you very much indeed.
Please, please.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah, very, very moving scene, that. And Maxine, that wouldn't work unless you're the right expert there.
Exactly.
To actually give the advice. So what makes a good expert?
Well, I also wanted to say that actually that Croix de Guerre belonged to our lovely captain, Captain Yvan Cadeau, his name was, and it belonged to his great-grandfather, which I don't think Joe even knew that, but he gave that away, which was terribly sick. Well, a good expert is terribly important and is somebody who can bring the story to life, who understands it, who can put something over to, you know, to the celebrity and to the audience, who's not, you know, so academic that nobody understands what they're talking about, but just can illustrate and can, you know, by using pictures, by using documents, and can speak the same language as the celebrity and just sort of open up this whole world, you know, and it's really important. We talk to the researchers, tend to talk to the experts to start with, and then once I come on board, which is 5 weeks before the shoot, and then the director comes on board 4 weeks before the shoot, we start to meet experts, and we will probably meet 3 or 4 experts per subject if we're lucky. But some experts have fantastic specialities, and I think we're about to see another clip of an expert that, a local expert that Larry met on his journey, and somebody that we've used quite a lot.
That's right. Sheffield University has helped out with some experts for the series. So, yeah, if we could take a look at that. And that's Larry's clip.
Morning.
Morning. Welcome to the National Fairground Archive.
Good morning. Professor.
Professor, yes. Vanessa.
Vanessa. Professor, yes. Vanessa.
Know,
fantastic. Fantastic.
Many jokes about that.
I was going to say you should try being Larry Lamb.
So do you want to know something about your family?
Yes. I'd like to know as much as possible about the Day family.
Very famous show family. Let me show you some material.
That's the father of my grandfather, as it were.
Yes.
That's it.
Yeah. Albert's son, Albert, was living with his uncle, yeah. James Day, or Jimmy Wild Beast Day.
Jimmy Wild Beast.
And here we are.
That's Jimmy Wild Beast, isn't
yes.
it?
Yes. Yeah. Fantastic costume, you
yeah.
can see.
Mexican bandido
yeah.
mixed up with a cowboy, mixed up with a pirate.
Yeah.
And he knows how to strike a pose.
Yeah. And then, what's really interesting, probably the most famous of all the Day brothers, who was even more exotic, is this guy, Martini Bartlett, and he was known as the Lion King, the King of the Lion Tamers.
Ha! Mm-hmm. Martini Bartlett, a lion tamer.
Well, it sounds like more exotic than
things
Tom
in
Day.
The world, don't you dare.
And this is Martini.
God, look at him.
Very handsome.
So Martini Bartlett would have been my actual granddad's uncle.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He'd have been like a great great uncle of mine.
He's your great great uncle. Yeah.
And hey. Martini Barlett.
A really famous showman. And we've actually got some material, some interviews with him, reminiscences of him and his life. And are you okay?
Yeah. You're completely overwhelmed.
Do you know, Larry, you did look overwhelmed then, and I'm just wondering, you know, what you looked almost like you were going to burst into tears. What brought that on?
It's funny, watching it, it sort of made me feel now sort of quite emotional. I think what it is, it's that connection. I think that was at the point when I actually did make a connection with the people in the world that I work in, that I'm directly connected back to, when, as we sort of discovered in the making of it, I'd never felt any connection with it at all. I'd been somebody that wandered in off the street, you know, there was a sign out there saying actors required, and I sort of went in. And so that was it, that was the point there, and I'm connected to somebody that looks like this, that did that, and he was a lion tamer. I mean, so far removed from anything that I could possibly be, you know, a lion tamer. And I phoned my mum. Mum, you're never going to guess what your great-great-uncle Tom... Oh, yeah, what was that? He was a lion tamer. Oh, well, I never... You'd never have made a lion tamer, would you?
Extraordinary.
Can I just say, I want to say this just on the question of experts. I'm sure that Larry won't mind if I say this, but you know, a lot of talk about, you know, the stars of who you think you are, you know, are the celebrities. But actually... I think the real stars of who you think you are the experts, and that what is great about this, and we couldn't do the show without them, and you know they're and up and down the country there are academics, there are librarians, there are local historians. Some of them are professional, some of them do it as a day job, some are just passionate amateurs, and their passion for their. And some of them are specialising in the weirdest kind of arcane subject matter. But that, and it's I think it's, you know, I mean, it's interesting. I mean, it's I actually do think, I mean, we do this show all over the world, but there's something peculiarly British about that sort of passion for the kind of strange and arcane and wonderful and record keeping, and I have this kind of, I don't know, I have this sort of. Next year, at the end of the next series, we will have reached the 100th episode, and I've got this sort of plan. I'd like to have a party, and I'm going to invite. Obviously, we'll invite all the celebs, you know. But more importantly, I'd like to invite all the experts. I'd like to invite everyone who has contributed to the show, because I really think, you know, it's a bit like Jo Rowling and her, you know, her kind of ancestor. They're the unsung. Heroes of this show, and I just like in public, yeah. I think, you know, pay tribute to them, because and without them we would not have the show we have.
And the genealogists as well. I mean, you know, and then we have an expert genealogist who works full time on this. I mean, the work that goes into it, and also the way they can interpret the documents. You know, I mean, it is extraordinary.
Do you know, Larry? I want to come straight back to you about your episode, but before I just do that, just a question for Leo and for Maxine that. We've even had Jeremy Paxman break down in tears on the show. I mean, you must get that moment of, yes, we've got it. We've got TV gold. No. So do you set out to try and make people cry?
Honestly?
Yeah.
No, you don't. I mean, it has to... Of course, you hope there's going to be an emotional reaction, but it doesn't have to be tears. There's different nuances to how people react. And I think you saw that with Larry. Emotion can come in different ways. But... When I'm directing and I'm in the moment,
you make everybody cry. When you're directing.
Not only do I make everyone cry, but I start crying myself, because if you're feeling it, you feel it. You know, it just the scene merits it, and I think that's the way it happens.
And I think I have to say, you know, this is the interesting, this the crossover that, you know, it sounds very straightforward, but the capturing of what happens in those scenes on the camera is what the director does. He communicates that, and it is not easy, and knowing that you've got to get it, because there ain't no going back on that moment. You know, you can't say, oh, you've got to get it.
So we missed that, can you just cry again?
Can you just cry again? Can you get that again? Can you get that moment a bit? And to do that When you when one considers the amount of preparation in doing something like that in a dramatic production, the months and months of planning that will take to encapsulate something like that, and this is done wallop bang, mostly with up against the clock. It's quite extraordinary.
And it doesn't always happen the way you think it's going to happen as a director either. Celebrities can react differently to different documents. They might find one element of a story much more emotional than you'd anticipated. And I suppose the people we haven't really talked about are the crew.
Yeah.
I can only speak for the people I work with, but the J.K. Rowling clip was shot by Johan Perry, and the sound was by Tony Burke. Now, both those people are absolutely top of the tree. They are brilliant at what they do. And it doesn't work unless they are working with me and Matt.
And they feel it as well, don't they? They
absolutely.
Really feel it.
And we work as a team. They travel with the celebrity that they become friendly with, and it becomes a real journey for all of us. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the most successful films have that element. Yeah.
But I guess, Leo, you know, you've researched it, so you know where that moment might happen. I don't suppose you put six cameras on it just to make sure you get that done.
One.
Sometimes we
six cameras.
That'd
be nice.
Actually, funnily enough, I've just started shooting with two cameras because the technology's changed so much now compared to even a few years ago that it's much easier to shoot with more than one camera. But for the most part, no, that whole JK scene was shot with one camera.
Yeah. So, Larry, coming back to your episode, I just need to ask you, you expanded your family network during the filming. Was that a pleasant surprise?
My family, extraordinary to find I've got these cousins all over the world, everywhere. You know, there are day show people everywhere. And then, of course, the whole Jewish side of the family. And 2 days, or the day after the thing came out, whereas in the story we'd gone as far as on the birth certificate, it said that the father of my grandmother was John Rose, licensed peddler, resident in Edinburgh. And then a Jewish genealogist sent me a family tree. And I found out the following day that John Rose was part of a big extended German-Jewish family that came over as manufacturers of waterproof goods to Edinburgh and settled in Dundee. And because my son's mum's family are all from Dundee, and she was up there, and I phoned her up and I said, Linda, you're never going to believe this, but these people I'm related to, this Jewish family, were all from Dundee. And she was in the room with her 92-year-old mother, and she called across the room and she said, Mum, I've got Larry on the phone, and they're related to this family in Dundee, a Jewish family called Rose. Do you know where the synagogue is in Dundee? Well, she said, dear, you should know, your father built it. So this extraordinary sort of circle all the way around, and there am I, you know, married to somebody whose old man built the synagogue that these people went to.
It was an extraordinary story. Have you kept in touch with people since you filmed it?
The Day family, yeah, definitely. I was subsequently made a lifetime honorary member of the Showman's Guild. I think that's sort of my highest accolade to date. I mean, it's quite extraordinary. But yeah, like an extraordinary connection with so many of them.
Yeah, and do you know, with I suppose you've got to be very careful here, aren't you? Because you're invading people's privacy to a big degree. And how much as a director do you kind of know when to back off?
Well, we talked about the J.K. Rowling incident, but it was just before the Levinson inquiry started. And I don't know if you remember, but she was one of the key witnesses at that inquiry. And the Rebtops had been really having a go at her, particularly the Mail and the Murdoch Press. And she was really, really scared about what would happen if they got a hold of this story that she'd said her great-grandfather was a war hero and been awarded the Légion d'honneur, and it wasn't true. She was really, really worried about that. So we had to... It was quite difficult, wasn't it, dealing with that situation. I reiterate, you are not allowed to tell them what's going to happen. And she got it into her head that we'd got some awful story and that her great-grandfather had actually been shot for cowardice or something like that. So we had to be very careful about not pressing her too hard. And I kept on saying to her, let the story unfold. And that was all I was allowed to say. But, she was really, really worried, and so were her representatives, I have to say.
Sometimes you do have to reveal some things that actually they might not... You know, they've signed up to do it, but they might not like to know about some of their relatives, that they were involved in slave trade, or, and it's quite difficult sometimes that you have to kind of almost prepare the way a little way without giving too much away. You know, it can be quite delicate.
I was at a session a couple of days ago here at DocFest with Roger Greif talking about the ethics of documentary filmmaking, and Roger talked very eloquently about how access, you know, to, I mean, the session was mainly about dealing with kind of vulnerable children and vulnerable adults, but actually I think it applies across the board about how it's a privilege to be given access to people's lives in this way. It's a gift, and with that comes a whole set of responsibilities. And Maxine's right. I mean, two things. I mean, one is that we at the beginning we're careful to sit down and explain. We can't tell them what is going to happen, but we're careful to explain. We want them to understand that they may come across things that are difficult, and they have to be prepared for that. And then at the end, it doesn't happen in every case, but I've always, there is a commitment there that if the celebrity wants it, we will show them a cut of the film before it's completed. To be very clear, we do not give them editorial control, and they understand that. They you know, but we will show them the film, and we will discuss in good faith anything in the film that they feel is inaccurate, or you know, because I think that's part of the kind of the pact. They don't get to change. Actually, to be honest, I can think of about only a couple of cases in 10 years where someone has actually had an issue with what was in the final film, and they've all been resolved amicably. But I think it is really important that there is a kind of a trust between the celebrity and the team.
Well, listen, that's been a fabulous insight, guys, into what goes off behind the scenes. I'd just like to throw that open to the audience now so we could have some questions from people if they'd like to direct them. I think we've got some mics in the audience, so if you've got a question, you want to stick your hand in the air, and then we'll get a mic to you, and then we'll start you going. Have we got somebody? We've got somebody down here. Could we get a mic down here, please? If you could just give us your name and then just address who you want the question to, please.
Is this one? I don't know. Yeah. My name's Helena, and I want to talk about the celebrity process of choosing who you have on the programme, and about, is it like your personal choice or is it as a team? And also, obviously, you want to get a good array of people. You can't just have actors, you can't just have TV presenters, and how you choose it for the series as well, so you have a good variety. And about like the history, obviously you said like in the first series that you had quite a range, you wanted Industrial Revolution, First World War. Do you take that into consideration with the choosing of celebrities? And have there been any stories that you thought just didn't make good TV and then you thought, oh, we'll just not bother with that anymore?
It's a really complicated process. I mean, the first thing to say is, you know, we in terms of the casting, I mean, the BBC has approval of casting, so all, you know, we discuss on a pretty ongoing basis with the BBC who we're casting. I say there's two things. One is, the first thing to say is we cast stories first and foremost, and my view is no one is too famous. No one is so famous that we would actually put a film out, and we've talked about this, you know, Michael Parkinson earlier. We would never do someone just because they were famous unless there was a really good story. So stories trump celebrity in that sense. Having said that, you know, it is a BBC One show. My kind of rule of thumb with the team is if you have to tell me who this person is, they're probably not right for who you think you are. That bloke from EastEnders is probably not enough. You know, it needs, you know, we need someone who's got, you know, a bit more in profile. So. And then you're right. I mean, it's a bit like, there are times when it gets a bit like three-dimensional chess, you know, how many men, how many women, how many, and also the kind of mix of stories as well as the mix of celebrities can be. We had a few years ago, we had a series where we had Esther Ranson, David Suchet, and Jerry Springer, all in the same series. And I mean, the scheduling of the show is actually a matter for the BBC. I mean, we make the programmes, but the ultimate decision about what order they go in is the BBC's. And they ended up scheduling these three series, all of which were really interesting stories, but they were all Eastern European Jewish narratives, and they all went out one after the other. And a few weeks after, I got in a cab, you know, one of those classic London cabbies. You know, he said, "Oh, what are you doing?" I said, "Oh, I make television." "Oh, yeah. What kind of shows?" And I said, "Oh, I make this show for the BBC. Who do you think you are? You know, where people go in search of celebrities." I went, "Oh yeah." She said, "Oh yeah, I like that show. It's a lot of shows. Jew, do you think you are?" That's London cabbies for you. And actually, funny enough, we've just started casting next year, and actually already, I mean, we've only really signed off on, as I said earlier, we've only really signed off on one name. We've got about 9 or 10 quite good names and stories that we're researching, and in the next few weeks we'll hopefully sign off on a few more. But actually, we've already had 3 really quite good Irish stories this time. It's really strange. I mean, one year it's the Jews, the next year it's the Irish. You know, it's like, you know. And I don't, so annoying. They're like buses. Yeah, it's like exactly right. You know, it's like, well, why can't you just, you know. So I mean, and so we're actually having quite serious discussion about whether we can have, you know, can we have 3, can we have 3 stories? I mean, we've got one way of dealing with it is partly about scheduling. I think, you know, we can have more than one story. I mean, this year we've got we've got Minnie Driver. We've also got Marianne Faithful, and they're both very different stories, but they're both stories essentially focused on World War II. So, I mean, one of our conversations with the BBC is, look, you don't want to put these two films out next to one another. One should go near the beginning, one should go to the end. But it can get a bit, and particularly towards the end, where you've got a, you know, when you get towards the end of the run of 10, you're towards the end of casting, and it's like, oh God, you know, you're trying to fit them in. We do sometimes actually pull a story from one run and hold it back for the next, just because it helps the mix, you know. I mean, the other challenge is, you know, we don't want the series to be completely white, you know. We want to have, you know, we try to find Asian and West Indian, Caribbean, African stories, and you know, that's sometimes quite tough. I mean, sadly, in my view, you know, there are not enough faces generally on television, you know, non-white faces, and it would be great if there were a few more. And so, but it is challenging. And the other thing which is challenging is that, you know, we go back. Those stories often take you back to the same. You know, they take you back. Inevitably, they take you back to the same bit of history. You know, they take you back. If you know the Indian subcontinent, you go back to partition. You go back. You know, and so you know, you're trying to find different ways to go back and tell the same story again: story of slavery or the story of the Indian subcontinent. So it's really quite complicated.
Do you have any more questions? One down in the front, and then somebody at the back up there. This gentleman at the front here, please.
Yes, hi, my name is Gerard. Obviously, it's a therapeutic exercise for the celebrity, but it's quite strange that if you're brought up in a sort of working class immigrant background and you ask your mum and dad about their parents or their grandparents, there's a reluctance, or my experience is there's a reluctance to talk about it. And it's almost seen as a self-indulgent exercise to talk about the past, and there's this need to move forward. So the series is good to that extent in that it enables people to relax about their past and ask those questions that they haven't been able to get from their immediate family. But to some extent, though, it is a self-indulgence, isn't it? And possibly the thing is that you go forward and don't indulge too much in the past. But the main point I make is that, for say, from a personal point of view, I have a history like everyone else, but I wouldn't get that history from my parents or grandparents because there'd be a reluctance to go there. And maybe that's the advantage of the program. It gives people the confidence to talk about their past.
Larry, you obviously went through the experience. What was the trigger that made you want actually to do the show?
It was really about my mother. It was my mother always thinking that she would one day meet her mother. And because the irony is that in the end, it could well have been, because my mother was born of a girl who gave birth to her age 17. And so my mum was in her 60s when her mother died, only 17 years older. So it could have happened. I mean, that was the interesting thing for me, to find out about my mum's life, because that was the one real unknown. She was adopted, and we didn't know anything about it. But I have to say, in response to what you're saying, is that, you know, in actual fact, what it's helped me a great deal to sort of go forward. And so whereas, you know, you can interpret it as a sort of a sense of self-indulgence, I mean, I think, you know, perhaps if you're locked into understanding all about the past, I'm actually fascinated by it, but in for me, it's answered a lot of questions, and I'm not quite so surprised about the way I am now as I had been previously. So it can do different things for different things for different people.
I think we've got a lady at the back.
Can I just pick up on that quickly?
Yeah, sure.
I mean, you're right, though. I mean, it's a generational thing. I've interviewed lots of older people who are really uncomfortable with some of the questions that they're being asked on camera, and never more so than when we made a film about Amelia Fox. She went to see her great aunts, one of whom was 104. And we started asking what I thought were fairly innocuous questions about family finance. And her 104-year-old great-aunt threw us out. she was blind and partially deaf, but when she cottoned on to what was actually being talked about, the finances of the family, that's enough! That's enough! We're not talking anymore about that! Out, out, out! Really? I think for that generation, in a film that we've just made with Minnie, I don't think I'm giving anything away, she goes to Middlesbrough to speak to a relative she never knew she had, who's a lovely, invites her in, cup of tea, really friendly. Yes, I knew your grandparents, yes. Do you know why they weren't married? Clam, no. And we never talked about things like that. And that was, you know, it's very much the change in personality was great, because it wasn't okay. There was a lot of shame involved in some of these stories. And that's what's great about this series. It uncovers personal history that really meant something to these families. It's, you know, the bigamy and all the things that we think are exciting were incredibly shameful to these families and very common as well.
I mean, the other interesting thing is the war. I mean, I think your point is that, I mean, one of the things that we've uncovered, I mean, I've done a lot of films about the Second World War and perhaps more even profoundly the First World War. And there was a generation, I mean, the men of those generations didn't talk about it. I mean, partly, I think for a number of different reasons. Sometimes it was just, I mean, we saw a little clip of Hugh Dennis on there, and you know, Hugh had that experience. I mean, that generation, either what they saw was so painful and horrible that they just basically edited it out, couldn't bear to talk about it, or I think more often than not, they didn't see it as being particularly worthy of comment. You know, they just went, you know, they went there, and in those days, that's what you did. You know, you went there, you went, you know, whether it's the war or the kind of the depression, they just lived through it. They didn't see themselves as particularly heroic or particularly dramatic, their lives. And so I think that, I mean, in some ways I'm quite glad of that, because actually I think it helps, strangely, it helps to make the show more dramatic. It's one of those things, it's like there is a kind of wall there sometimes that we have to get through. So there's another question up the back somewhere. Yeah.
My name is Barbara. I'm in the television production business. I'm very interested in the structure of the production. Like, what kind of researchers do you have? What are their backgrounds? How long do they work on the story? You mentioned earlier about it's 5 weeks before the producer comes on, 4 weeks with the director. Then how long through that process? And then normally how long are the shoots and then into the edit suite?
So the researchers tend to be history graduates, I think, have an interest in history. And it kind of depends a little bit on the story and how easy it is to sort of research it. But I think there is a statistics that it's about 30 weeks of research goes in per film. It kind of depends a little bit about which area you're looking at, but it's a huge long period. I mean, some films you can research in probably, you know, 12 weeks or something, but overall it does vary. So the research is on, you know, and they might be working on several celebrities. They're looking at several celebrities at once. But, you know, we have a bank of about, I don't know, 6 to 8 researchers who are working continually throughout the year. Sorry, and you wanted to know, sorry.
And then from that phase, how long, you come on, the director comes on.
Oh, yes. So I come on with 5 weeks to go to the shoot. And I sort of try and I look at the stories and I try and write an outline for the film. And then the director comes on, looks at my outline. If it's Leo, he throws it out of the window. We make it, absolutely not. No, we make a decision together and with Alex which stories we're going to try and follow. And then we will go and do more research, visit all the people concerned. We will meet our celebrity just once before we film. And then we start filming, and it's a 9-day filming period for UK, and then if it's 10 days for abroad. And we film absolutely as you see it. You know, we'd start with the main interview, usually in the celebrity's home, and then we follow the story absolutely as it goes. So we, you know, yeah, absolutely in order, because you have to do it. You know, it's their story, and it's that's the joy of working on this thing as well. You go through the whole process with them, and it has to be filmed in that way.
I mean, for the documentary filmmakers in the audience, I mean, who do you think you are is a very peculiar animal in that way. You know, I mean, most factual programs, most documentaries, the order in which things are shot bears little, if any, relationship to the order. You know, people, you often film the front of a film, very last thing. You know, you and you have an enormous amount of freedom in the edit to shift things around and sometimes literally flip the film inside out if it's not working. That isn't the case on Who You Think You Are. In that sense, Leo's point earlier about it being much more like a drama applies to the edit as well. The truth is, pretty much, by and large, when you watch a Who You Think You Are, the first thing you see is the first thing we shot, and the last thing you see is the last thing you shot, and it pretty much follows sequentially because there is no other way to do it, because you are unfolding the story as it goes along. Sorry, you were going to say.
No, about that, and that'll do me.
How long was the edit?
7 weeks.
7 weeks.
Yeah, Leo's films get 10, but...
For Leo.
I'm just... 7 weeks, yeah.
Do we have any more questions? Oh, we've got quite a few now. Okay, can we have this gentleman here, please?
Hello. Hello, I'm Adrian. Just want to ask, you were saying about celebrities that you've eventually got someone back because a friend did it. Do you have celebrities coming to you to do programmes about them? Do they come to you and ask you to do it? And to Larry, have you talked about it to your actor friends and they've said, oh, I'd be interested in something like that?
Yeah, I mean, for me to answer your question about me, I know three friends and colleagues that have done it subsequently, and they've all asked me what it was like. All of them. Mm. You know, they phone up and say, you know, what was he like? So it helps, you know, that to know somebody that's been through the experience and not to think, oh, there's going to be elements of it that are going to be unpleasant.
Of course, that's another reason why it's very important. I mean, it's important anyway, from an ethical point of view, for us to treat the celebrities well and make sure they have a good experience. But cynically, it's also because at the end of the day, you know, that world of show business is a relatively small world. A lot of people know a lot of other people. And so the chances are that if a celebrity who's going to come and do our show, if they know someone like Larry, they're going to pick up the phone and say, so what was it like? Should I do this? Was this a good experience? Were you treated well? So it's very important to do that. It has got easier over the years. I'd say the first series was the hardest because we didn't even know what we were making, let alone trying to persuade the celebrities what it was. And so it was very difficult to cast the first couple of series, really. Now, I wouldn't say it's ever easy. I mean, it's still quite hard work, but it is now that people know it, and we do get people. I mean, you have to be slightly wary of that. I mean, one of the things that I feel strongly is that we want to make sure that people come on the show because they really, really want to do the show. I think their motivation, that they're actually genuinely interested in the subject and, you know, genuinely interested in wanting to know more about their family history. Occasionally, now, I think, you know, curiously, Who Do You Think You Are is seen as a kind of show that might rescue your slightly failing career.
It did mine.
We're happy to help out where we can. Oddly enough, you know, I mean, as keen though we are to get people on board, if we get a call from an agent saying, oh, so-and-so would really like to do it, we're a little bit wary until we've got to meet them and we're confident that they really, really want to do it. They're not just doing it because they think it's the thing to do.
Hmm. Okay, let's come to this side again. Can we have this lady at the front here, please?
Hiya, Ibona from Getty Images. I was just wondering, as the format has travelled in the international versions, have there been any stories that you've seen or heard about that you had wished that you could have worked on for the UK BBC version? It might have been that it's already been done, or the person is popular in the local territory but not necessarily here. And also, as the there's a programme in the States that's a different format, but it's in the same genre. I think it's Finding Your Roots on PBS. I've enjoyed it, but it wasn't as emotional, I felt. It's more presenter-led. They had celebrity couples. They had three different celebrities in a series. Do you have like a sense of pride that even now the genre is still interesting and people are still commissioning that sort of production, or a little bit annoyed that they've kind of nubbed your idea?
So can I just be clear about your first question? Are you saying are there episodes that I've seen that have been produced in other countries?
In different territories, yeah.
The stories they've done that I wish we had done, or that actually think, oh, that film would work really well in the UK?
A bit of both. Has there been any stories that they're like, wow, that their history was so phenomenal, I wish that we could have done, or I wish I worked on it, or just enjoyed it for the fact that it was an interesting story?
Given my limitations of language, I haven't really been able to indulge myself with the Czech or the Portuguese versions, necessarily. But I'm astounded. I spend quite a lot of time. One of the nice spin-offs of this is I get to, I was in Rio a couple of months ago talking to the Brazilians. They're about to do a Brazilian version, I was in Prague and Lisbon. I'm not sure many of those stories would have worked here. But I'm constantly amazed. We have the partners in Australia in the audience. I think they're making their sixth series in Australia. It's a huge success for SBS in Australia, and I've seen quite a lot of the episodes from Australia. And whereas I think there are not that many of the episodes that would work in the UK, just because there are not that many of them that are household names here. We steal the Australians, that's right. Yeah, we steal the Australians, that's true. I've seen some fantastic episodes. Australia, of course, some of the American episodes are really extraordinary. It is an amazing format. It's rather extraordinary. On your other point about other shows, who do you think you are was not the first genealogy series on TV? And it's certainly not the last. Imitation is the sincerest form of flattery. I don't worry about that. I think it's great. There's room for lots of different ways of doing things. I don't spend a lot of time worrying about that. I spend most of my time worrying about the fact that 10 years on, I want our show to be as good as it's ever been. That's the challenge, is not to become complacent, not to become lazy, not to become self-satisfied. I'm not really worried about everyone else. People can do what they like.
There's something special about who you think you are, though, because it does work in a different way to the other genealogy shows.
And I think it's more emotional because it's the celebrity telling their story, where I felt the other one was great, but it was the presenter just sitting at the table and laying it out for them. It didn't feel as emotional.
There is a direct connection with the viewer and the celebrity that doesn't exist in any other show that I work with, in which I think you live vicariously through the story of that person and you relate very personally to their story. And what I love about working on it, it gives me a sense of being part of history. And I think the viewer gets that very much. I think the celebrity gets that. And that's the beauty, the magic of it, is that you feel part of history when you're making it.
Leo, I think we might just have time for one final very quick question. If somebody's got a very quick question, for the lady at the back there, please, can we just...
Hi, I'm Jessica. My question is for the team. Given your central involvement in the programme, have any of you looked into tracing your own family histories? I'm assuming you have. And if not, has it inspired you to look at it in any greater detail? And do you have any stories you could share?
Can we just have very quick answers on those, please?
I'm going to start here. 2 weeks ago, I found out that my grandfather was the heavyweight champion of Australasia. And I've never known that before.
And I'm a bit like June Whitfield because I have an aunt who's done all the research, so it was already done, and so it hasn't inspired me, but I think it's a brilliant background.
I've just been too bloody busy doing Who You Say You Are. But my mum was obsessed with the fact that I am... I'm somehow descended from the first Duke of Montrose, James Graham, in the 17th century. And apparently there's a snuff box in our family, and if we could only find it. And then apparently there's a castle in Scotland waiting for me. So when I get a moment, I'm going to go and do that. You know.
All right, well, I'm sure you're all going to join in, helping me to thank our fantastic lineup of guests that we've had today. That's Alex, Leo, Maxi, and Larry. And just one final treat for you. I forgot to introduce myself right at the beginning. I'm digital editor from The Star. My name is Graham Walker, and because I'm a newsman, I always like to end with a bit of an exclusive. And we've got one for you. We've got a clip here that's going to promote to the 10th series, with 10th anniversary series, 100th edition coming up as well. So if we can just run that clip.
This is again, a sneak preview. We had to get preview special permission from the BBC to show you this, so nobody else has seen this anyway.
Isn't that great? Isn't that fantastic?
That's gorgeous.
I think everybody thinks, is there somebody in the past who's squandered me inheritance?
Who spent our money?
Why didn't we meet his parents? So strange. Oh, I hope we can find out.
I've landed at the airport in Radcot, and my cousins picked me up to go and see my mum's sister.
Oh, John, you got another one. Now we're talking.
Oh, my God. That's my father. Is that my father?
My gunner was very prompt with the fire and beat it out with his gloved hands. That's Dad.
That's your father, yes.
And I remember she was quite heavily bearded, actually. I refused to give her a kiss when she came to stay with Granny. And she said, well, in that case, you're not getting your half crown, which I thought was fair enough.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have kissed her for 5 bob, actually.
Oh, dear. I've been playing those sort of parts for years.
The game is commenced between the two goals, which are about 100 yards asunder. If it ends in a draw, it's a penalty shootout, and the Germans win. That's unbelievable.
It's really weird to be furious about somebody who's been dead a long time, but I'm absolutely furious. And if you stood the men in front of me now who abandoned him, I wouldn't be able to take my hands off.
Your family is the ground you stand on. And what has happened is that the ground has been put back. I'm very lucky. Thank you.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I can't wait. I mean, that's been fantastic. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.